to start by answering the first question that comes to people's minds when they meet, and that is, what ethnicity am I? I like to say I'm half Filipino and half Arkansas. My two favorite foods that I love to make that I have a really good recipe for are business and gravy and chicken adobo. I want to share with you guys my Filipino-American experience to answer the second question that people have when they meet me, and sometimes it's uncomfortable to ask, which is, how did I end up in a wheelchair, which Romeo just explained and stole my thunder, but how I ended up in a wheelchair and how I survived and thrived such an injury. So let's take it back to the beginning. My dad was drafted into the military in the 70s, and he was stationed in Manila, where he met my mom, and they fell in love, and he brought her back here to the States, and they started a family, and I came along. How many of you can relate to that for your parents or grandparents? Anyone? Some of you can. Well, for me, that's actually a complete and total lie. My dad was the Filipino bartender. I gotta pull up my slide here. And my mom was the white waitress at the Hacienda in Fresno. And I was a surprise. And they tried to make it work. And most people, though, they assume that the Filipino dad, Filipino mom and the white dad from overseas is the story when they meet me. Today, most people don't guess Filipino when we're trying to figure out what my identity is. My first job out of college, I moved to Boston, and I used to hang out in Little Italy. And I loved this one cigar bar owned by a guy named Big Kenny. And Big Kenny looked like Mr. Clean. He was bald head, buff dude, white shirt, jeans. And we walked into the place. All the women, they kissed the cheek, and all the men, they kissed the ring. Big Kenny was a connected guy, if you know what I'm saying. And one day, he looked at me and he said, "Hey, kid, come over here. Yeah, what's your name?" "Balucas." "Yeah, Balucas. You could be Italian." And I was going to disagree with Big Kenny. I said, Yeah, I'm Italian, from a little town in between Pisa and Firenze, right in Tuscany. And he said, "Yeah, Balucas, I knew you were Italian." I luckily had studied in Italy in college, and so I knew what I was talking about, and I always got away with it. So whenever I went back, Big Kenny was like, "Hey, that's that kid Balucas, come over here." A couple years later, I was in Hawaii for a wedding, and I wanted to buy an ukulele and learn how to play. And so the day after the wedding, I went to an ukulele shop that a Hapa Hawaiian friend recommended to me. And I went in, and I was staring at the wall, and the guy said to me, "Hey, anything you want to play, pull up the wall." And I didn't say anything, I just stared at the wall for about 15 minutes because I was too scared to say, I didn't know how. And the guy came over and he said, "You know how to play, right?" I said, "No." He goes, "No?" And he pulled off a ukulele, taught me the four chords I need to know, and I got my first lesson in how to play the uke. And as I was buying that uke, he said, "You look like you're from here until you open your mouth." So one part of being Hapa is being able to blend in to different cultures. And when I was a kid, I looked a lot younger, or a lot more Asian. And the kids used to tease me and call me Ching Chong China Eyes. And by that time, my mom and I had moved to Seattle. And like I said, I looked way more Asian as a kid. And I would go home to my white mom and say, "You know, hey, like, I'm not Chinese. Why are they making fun of me and calling me Chinese?" My mom recognized that she wanted me to have a connection to my Filipino side. And luckily, my dad's brother, Fred, lived in Seattle as well. Many people know Fred Cordova and Dorothy Cordova as the founders of the Filipino-American National Historical Society. They're basically the foremost authorities on cataloging the Filipino experience in the United States. And I was lucky enough to call him my uncle, and Aunt Dorothy my aunt. And my mom would take me over there, and I would play with my cousins, and Uncle Fred cataloged our entire family tree. And it started with my grandmother, Margarita, who was the matriarch. She came from the Philippines through Hawaii to California and settled in the Central Valley. She had three husbands, one affair, 13 children, 9 of which that survived birth into adulthood, and my dad, Ernie, was the youngest. When I was born, I became the youngest of the youngest, so I was the youngest third generation of the youngest second generation, and I was one of 31 first cousins. It's a big family. And every summer, or every other summer, we would have family reunions. This is this past summer up in the Bay, and I got to hang out with my cousins, who were Filipino and white, they were Filipino and black, they were Filipino and Filipino, they were Filipino and Jewish, they were Filipino and Mexican, or Mexipino, as they like to be known. And having those connections to my family really taught me my place in this huge tree. When I also had connection to my Arkansas side, because I would spend the other half of my summer in on a farm in Texas. My grandfather from Arkansas and his family bought a little farm in a little town, Woodson, Texas, population 251. And I would go from Seattle to this Texas town, and I literally learned how to shoot a gun, drive a tractor, rustle cattle, fish, everything. It was full-on little tiny cattle ranch. And Grandma taught me how to make biscuits and gravy from scratch. Cornbread and grits were the real deal at Grandma's kitchen. And having that connection to both sides of my ethnicity gave me an identity. It taught me the two sides of who I was, and it allowed me to make that something that I could take pride in, instead of being something that I could be mocked for or be made fun of. When it came time for college, like I said, I lived in Seattle, and I assumed I was gonna go to the University of Washington, or UW, with all of my friends from high school. And when I would visit my dad in the summers in Fresno, I learned about this school on a hill overlooking the ocean in Malibu called Pepperdine. And when it came time, I just looked it up just to see what it was all about. And I saw that my GPA and my SAT score were right in the middle of the students who are accepted to Pepperdine. So I just decided to apply to see if I could get in. But I knew I was going to go to the University of Washington. But I got in. And I got the big envelope instead of the little envelope. And then I got the financial aid package that left me about $5,000 short of going to the second most expensive school in California, right? And I wrote it off, because I just, $5,000 was a lot of money back in those days, as I'm sure it is today. And it was a year and a half of in-state tuition at the University of Washington, so I just wrote it off. But sitting in my room, in high school, I had this poster of Michael Jordan. I was a huge Michael Jordan fan. And Michael Jordan wrote a book called I Can't Accept Not Trying, in which he wrote, I can't accept not trying. What he wrote was, I can accept failure. Everybody fails at something, but I can accept not trying. And it kind of made me look again at Pepperdine and figuring out how could I find that money. He also wrote, you miss 100% of the shots that you don't take. So, for the first time, I was presented with a major challenge, with a major opportunity behind it, and I was presented with the opportunity to rise up. And someone else asked me as I was trying to find a way, they said, Rob, here's the thing. Could you live with yourself sitting at the University of Washington in a 500-person classroom, wondering where you would be if you were in Malibu right now? And the answer immediately was no. I couldn't. I have to take the chance. And I got to redefine the idea of failure from not being able to hack it and having to come home to not even trying in the first place. So I got crafty. I got my parents and my grandparents. My karate school gave me a scholarship. When I opened that door, other random people came out of the woodwork and offered scholarships, and I raised the money to go to Pepperdine. And I went, and I was scared. I wasn't sure if I could hack it a semester, a quarter. I didn't know if I'd be able to pay for the following year. But it was exactly where I was supposed to be. And I didn't just hack it, I actually thrived. They had a Filipino club. My roommate was Filipino. We played in the friendship games here in SoCal. I was an international business major, so I studied in London, I studied in Italy. And in 4 years, in 2 summers, I graduated Pepperdine as the first in my family, my grandparents, my parents, and my siblings, to graduate college with a college degree. A lot of you here are students in a time where you're making crucial decisions, where you're going to make a few big decisions and a lot of little decisions that guide the course of your life and how you live it. This is that time where you can rise up. There's one more story I want to share before I hit that punchline, which is that college was not all fun and games, of course. There were some moments that were interesting. My senior year, I had a roommate who wasn't a horrible person by any means, but we didn't get along. We bumped egos a lot. And he, I think I was probably running my mouth about Filipino pride or bumping my hip-hop music too loud. And he took me in the bathroom and said, "Look in the mirror." And he got in my face, he got right in my ear, and he said, "Dude, you're white." And I don't remember exactly what I did or if I even said anything, but what I knew was he was right. I am white and I'm Filipino. And being white doesn't make me any less Filipino. And being Filipino doesn't make me any less white. But more than that, what I knew was this dude does not get to decide who or what I am. I decide. I decide whether or not I get to make business and gravy or chicken adobo. I get to decide whether I'm going to bump some hip-hop or whether I'm going to go swing dancing at the derby. I decide. You, like I was saying, you guys are going to make a lot of decisions right now that are big. My biggest message I want to get through to you guys today is that don't worry what other people think. Worry about what you think. When I woke up in an ICU bed 2 years ago, I had been training for a triathlon, and I was on mile 40 of 45. I was looking and feeling good. I was on mile 40 of 45. I was almost done. I was on a gradual climb, and I was finally on some downhill switchbacks. I was gaining speed, and I just misjudged this road I hadn't been on before, and it was a really sharp turn ahead. I lost control of my bike. I went over the side of the hill. That was my view. I went straight over the side of that hill. I went straight over my handlebars. The rest I don't remember. I woke up, though, about 20 feet down that hill. A log had broken my fall. That same log that broke my fall also broke my collarbone. It broke my, cracked all my ribs on my left side. It collapsed my left lung and broke my back. An L1 burst fracture. That's what that looks like. They put me into surgery the next day, and in 8 hours, laying on my stomach, they fused my spine with screws and rods, and I ended up a paraplegic in a wheelchair, of course. When I woke up after that surgery, the doctors, the nurses, the physical therapist, the occupational therapist, they were all standing around and they said, "We need to challenge this guy as soon as possible. He's an elite athlete." And I was pretty drugged up, but I was laughing to myself in my head because I'm no elite athlete. I've never won a triathlon. It's never been even a thought in my head. Before I had done my first triathlon, I was not a swimmer. I was not a cyclist, and I was definitely not a runner. I just decided to do a triathlon to see where my limits were and see if I could push them. No one ever made fun of me for not coming in first, and no one made fun of me for coming in 535th like I would. It was just a fun opportunity to be out there and compete. So when this doctor said, "He's an elite athlete," I was like, "Hey, another identity that someone has for me. That's great." But I actually like this one. And the doctor also said to me, he said, "You know, the long path of triathlon, of training that it takes to compete, will help you on the long road of recovery and rehabilitation. from this injury. And that really set in for me, because it did help, because in the same way that I wasn't a triathlete before I tried triathlon, I had to learn how to sit up on my own with no control from here down. I had to learn how to get in and out of this wheelchair. And the first few days, I was like, that bed is so far away, that feels like a mile. Where today, I do it all the time. So it benefited me knowing that just by going out over and over and over again, and training and trying again and trying again and getting a little better every time, that it became a common thing for me. There was a paratriathlete he's the man in paratriathlete, his name's Carlos Moleda. I came across him and he inspired me to do triathlon, and he said, if I have to be the guy in the wheelchair, I'm gonna be the best guy in the wheelchair. And I thought, yeah. And I set a goal in that ICU bed to do a triathlon within a year of my injury. And I did three. I did a sprint triathlon in Santa Cruz. I did Malibu triathlon. I did the Oakland triathlon. This year, I did as a relay because of injury, but I did the Escape from Alcatraz triathlon with a lot of hills at 3 miles an hour through San Francisco. I did Santa Cruz again. I did Malibu for the second time as a paratriathlete. And tomorrow, I'm going to San Diego to ride 44 miles as a triathlon relay team in the San Diego Triathlon Challenge with the Challenge Athlete Foundation, with hundreds of other physically challenged kids and adults like myself. Next month, I'm planning on doing a half marathon, and next year I hope to do one, if not two, half Ironmans. And like I said, if you ask me why, where the heck do I get all this energy? It's because I've decided to rise up, to find that limit of what I think I'm good at, what I think I can do, and push it a little further, and then push it a little further, and then push it a little further. Really, it's just because I decide. My question to you guys is, what do you guys decide? I hope you guys rise up.